Make sense to you?
Yeah, makes sense to you.
Okay. All right. What you got?
Yeah, so I'll be playing like, on the fourth and fifth note of Shostakovich's Symphony Number 9.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Great. Whenever. Sure. Great.
Let's play a couple notes.
This brass progression of chords, boom, crash, gong,
and then hum in the strings, and then comes this, right? So the first iteration is primarily plaintive. It does have a high point to it. The question then becomes, what is the meaning of that high point? Does it approach accusation? Does it anger, defiance, or is it? I would argue that it's more of a passionate cry, pleading, or of desperation than it is of anger. Okay, and that's about partly about how you feel when you're doing it that gets translated into what we hear. Part it's about the broad usage. Part it's about how it is. Part about how it's attacked. How it's sustained. How it resolves. All those things. We can start at the top again, and I'm going to ask him for other really subtle nuances that really aren't really about the basic character of it, because I really like what he's doing, the basic character of it, and it's basically quite good. So let's see if he can evolve it just a little bit. I'll start from the top. Set the mood in your mind. So you're going to sit here, and before you play this in an audition, and obviously if you're performing it live, it's all set. The table's set by what happens around you. But if you're in an audition, you have to set the table yourself in your mind. And that's whatever way critical. Okay? So you're going to use your imagination as your best asset there, which is rather than just sort of playing this thing and hoping it, and getting a couple bars into it and realizing, oh, that's not quite what I wanted. I wanted it to sound more. You're going to imagine it all right from the get-go, what it sounds like to the accompaniment, to introduce the mood that you're now going to play into. Okay, so.
Thank you.
leave room to diminuendo. Okay. So don't get quite so soft before it. Okay. And then you play this.
Sure.
So, and right from the beginning, this is a different character than the first phrase is. The first phrase is, if I had to say, what's the theme in the first phrase? It's plaintive, it's desperate, it's remorseful, it's overwhelmed, it's beaten down, okay? So now it's pissed. It's this. So it starts, right? Like that's a different mood, even from the beginning of the attack on the situation, okay? Even if it's contained a little, because there's a long arc to this, it's got to build. But even from the get-go, what I would do is change the way I feel and what I'm thinking about. This. Like that. And I believe that that makes a huge difference in what comes out of the end of the horn. It's related to what else is happening inside, right? So I could calculate and say, well, I've got a little lever, a little more product, or I could just go, you know, and it accomplishes that, right?
Like that. Okay, I see. Fine.
Then I think what makes this work is to not play it so notey that it sounds, up like this. And the other thing I hear all the time with students is that they'll play, because this is written in groups of two, like this. They play ba 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 ba. I think just pretend it's just written all in one step, you know, one. So right? And then this sound, I think, tossed off, kind of.
Okay, next.
Perfect. Cool. Perfect. Yes, bring it more to life, okay? Along the lines of what you're already trying to do. So I don't have to, I'm not to convince you that it should be different somehow. It's just more about within what your paradigm already is, how to make it become alive, okay? I like what you're doing with these dotted 8/16 to the quarter note resolution. I like the arc of that, what you're doing. I would suggest to you that most often when I perform this, it's been slightly faster. Okay, so I think that you're setting a slightly, you know, kind of wishful thinking tempo. If you get more time to hang with it, you really will. So maybe let's do add one click to it, okay, and try again.
Okay. Thank you.
context, which is, first of all, I think I've never played it that slow. So let's play at a click faster, okay, to begin with. Then let's not be fractious about the way notes belong to each other. Let's not try to individuate those two. So like, for example, the beginning of this, when you play D, right? I don't want to sound da 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 da, but just play on D.
Thank you.
don't play ba 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 ba, play between the beats.
Yeah.
It's ba 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 ba. Every note that moves all the passage, every note is important, getting you to the goal. So you know, it sounds to me like you want to just go, your tendency is to want to go ba ba. Can you come back here, come back enough that there's room to make this impactful to there? So this ascending line delivers an arrival there rather than just stays the same way.
Okay.
That's
Thank you.
gets to carry the significant tune, and it's more important than any other instrument because it finishes. The oboe starts, obviously. The version the oboe does is decidedly different than this one, I think. And the oboe is stating in real time. This is the way I say it. The oboe is stating in real time. It's setting the table on the scene and defining the emotional content of the moment. It's telling you what the problem is. It's telling you the story. You know, there is this, and you can add to that story. You know, there's this sadness. Let me tell you about it, more or less. Okay, it's this sadness. This is how I feel. This is what happened. Right. Then the movement makes an effort at commenting and describing and developing that, and it sort of portrays the evolution of that, whatever that sentence is again the way I say it, including an attempt to get happy, and introduces a B theme that's a comic relief to that. Let's be happy. And ultimately speaking, with all the attempts to parse through this, understand it, overcome it, we're left with this at the end, and we return to it. And in a moment of quiet personal reflection, and my image is somebody sitting in a window alone, looking out over a sort of desolate landscape, maybe a gray day, and what I see is this passage is structured is that it starts as a person reflecting again on that subject that was introduced by the oboe. They're reflecting on it. And the way that I'm sure you can relate to, when you begin to think of an old painting, it starts as a thought. You remember it, it's a memory. And it's maybe something you don't really want to remember, right? But it's intrusive in its thought. So your mind goes to it and you can't ignore it, right? But as you think about it, it goes from being a memory to being a present feeling again. So now it's not then, but it's now, okay? So if you look at this passage and you divide it into two sections, the first section is the memory, and the second section is the now. It's feeling again, felt now again. Okay? So how does that play? You know? Well, if it starts slightly hesitantly, than is necessarily marked. I mean, what does he mark? His penis by the beginning. That's it. Let me ask you this. If you play the whole thing, penis blows out. And that's penis with the name. I mean, people would be going like, you know, it doesn't really work. I think he means how it should sound at the start. It's hesitant, bereft, tentative, you know? But I would argue that by the second phrase, he probably could have gotten away with it. He marked this for a sequel. He probably could have marked, you know, at least mezzo sequence, if not forte sequence. But if he marked that, then someone would play it. Tchaikovsky forte, right? That wouldn't work. So, you know, just let's trust the player. Let's trust the musician to know what to do with this, okay? So, another thing about this, the second phrase that might make this come to life, is that I think I hear this mistake, what I think is a mistake all the time, in especially young players. They play the passion and the dynamism, the espressivo, they try to make occur in the repeated dynamics with the accent, at the end. They make ba 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 be ba bum bum be ba be ba be ba bum bum be ba be ba. Don't think that's the right way to do it. I think that the passion that is in this Russian ji-ya-dum, that's where the tension is. And those dotted notes complete the thought. So ta da yum bum bum, pia yum bum bum. Okay? You just play ba 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 bum bum bum. It's somehow vapid if you haven't made that intervallic, you know, upward sweep. Make sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first phrase is slightly hesitant, and let's talk about the phrase at the beginning. Have you played B B B B B B B bum B ha la la? I think that's wrong. Okay. I don't think it's just interpreting, it's a mistake. It's B ha la 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 ba di ha la 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 la.
Okay.
Try to agree with that. And up, play up. It's fun. It's an amazing thing. Somehow people, they see that, they ideally understand it. It's not intellectually difficult to grasp. But then they're programmed to do something inside those four note groups. So they play da di da di da, or instead of just da di da da da, just natural. Okay. Try again at the top. dot and an accent. What do we do with that? Well, there's a data shape nature to it. But I mean, that could be anything, right? It could be da, which would be obviously not in the right field. So it's online. Mm-hmm. I would argue for tum, ta, ta, and the accent is not a carry, standing accent, it's a weight. It's an arrival that's from here and meaningful in terms of its overwhelming, ponderous, emotional import, rather than some kind of splashy gesture that's more, you know, physical or something. Like this. Make sense? Try to move.
Try the E flat key and the pan key
see what that is. No, start it or add it between this one and this one. So you start right there. And so it's good for flat. So you have to spin the sound a little bit more, otherwise you get dum, dum. You've got to go dum, oh, and carry a little bit more, otherwise it's just too aggressive, okay? That's something for your future and system improvement. Okay. Yeah, I don't like the way that sounds. I think it's a better vocal that was good for it. It's not worth poking around this vocal. Fine, I just need the vocal.
Okay.
All right. You think?
I think I understand much more how it.
You understand the first two phrases?
Yeah.
The first phrase as it relates to the second phrase.
Yeah.
I think that makes all the difference. Instead of just most people wander through this at a kind of slow, wistful march, and there's not really much of a plan to it, there's no arc. I think this is I think it's the right one, musically speaking, I think it's what it's trying to say. And it leaves you, at the end, in that bereft place of failure, of emotional, just emptiness. But I'll tell you what, play it like that, play it in tune like that, and if you see this, the community sitting there like, that's good for, this is the kind of moment where you can win a job. And they look at each other and say, that is special. Because everybody plays this, and most people just get through it and do something, and hopefully it's a tune, it's nice, they have something to say with it, but if it breaks a heart, different outcomes. Okay, thoughts? Ideas? Questions? If anybody. Okay. Good. Good job.